Sometimes in life, you buy yourself an AliExpress product with a 5-star rating, only to find out that it performs terribly. But that is why this video series exists, in which I test all kinds of AliExpress products, to tell you whether you should check them out or simply ignore them. And in case you're completely confused right now, AliExpress is an online shop based in China, where you can not only get the newest, weirdest, and sometimes super useful products, but also lots of garbage. And today I got another 8 promising looking products to test. So let's not waste any more time and let's get started. This video is sponsored by Rode & Schwarz. Now, as you might know, I love my Keysight test gear, but as an engineering graduate, I've worked with all kinds of different brands. And let me tell you that Rode & Schwarz makes some awesome test gear as well. In fact, you might spot it in future episodes. But I'm not here today to promote that. Instead, I want to tell you about their test and measurement YouTube playlists, where you can find 150 videos about simple, but also super advanced topics, broken down in helpful subcategories. So if you ever had any unsolved questions while measuring, feel free to check it out. Let's start off with a special LED strip I got myself 2 meters off for around 16 euro. Now when it comes to LED strips, I thought I've seen it all. And by that I mean we got our dumb single color or multicolor LED strips, whose LED brightness you can only control altogether, and then you got your addressable LED strips, where you can control each LED individually, because each one comes with its own control IC. But this new LED strip from AliExpress is something I have not yet seen before, and the big obvious difference here is that the LEDs are encapsulated in a silicone-like line. That of course diffuses the emitted light a lot better, in comparison to normal LED strips. I would still say it is not perfect though, but I think for many applications you would not need an extra diffuser system. I was also excited to see that it apparently features 630 LEDs per meter, which is a lot more than the densest LED strip I got laying around. And after peeling off the silicone line, I can actually confirm this number, even though their way of counting is a bit confusing. But since they use rather tiny LEDs, the maximum light output of them is quite a bit lower than more traditional LED strips, which is also noticeable when looking at their power consumption. And last but not least, as you might already have noticed, this LED strip also comes with ICs, meaning you can control the RGB color for every 7 cm of the strip. That is way less resolution than other addressable LED strips though. And worst of all, I was not able to control the LEDs while testing. The reason was that the utilized FL1903 control IC is still pretty unknown on the internet, and I only found a Chinese datasheet for it with the compliant timing diagrams. But since this timing is not supported by the Fast LED library, trust me, I tried, I pretty much had to stop my testing here, and would recommend everyone who's interested in such a diffused LED strip to buy them with a more popular control IC. So all in all, this kind of LED strip is not really a hidden gem for me, because the only real advantage it comes with is better diffusion, and that is something I like to add on my own. Okay, moving on to this box filled with weird looking sleeves that are actually heat shrinkable wire connectors, which I got a pack of 300 for around 12 euro. Now usually when it comes to connecting wires, I love to use Vago connectors, but those are quite a bit more expensive in comparison. They are not waterproof, do not work with lots of wire sizes, and I somehow also think that they feature a higher contact resistance than the heat shrinkable thingies. So I of course had to try them, which I did with 3 different wire sizes, by simply following these 3 shown steps here. and for the most part everything went pretty smoothly, even though the twisting part was a bit hard to do with thin wires. But as you can see, the solder connection formed in all cases successfully, because that is what we're basically doing here, using a heat gun to melt solder and thus fuse two wires together. And it also seems like all connections were waterproof. And after doing the electrical resistance test with one of them and a Vago one in comparison, it was also clear that it features a slightly lower resistance, meaning it can be used for higher current applications. So it almost seems like the ideal connector that can also withstand my brute force. But let me tell you that you cannot join more than two wires together, stiff conductors are out of the question because that does not hold up, and it also takes a while to use this connector, while Vago ones can do all of that and are quick to use. But all in all, I would still highly recommend them, especially for vehicle repairs or similar. Next, I got myself this small 5-volt fan for around 12 euro. And I know, such a product does not really sound exciting at first, because it can basically only cool off components or similar. But by simply flipping it around, it can also be used as a fume extractor, whose size is a lot smaller than other commercial solutions out there. The only thing missing was a proper filter, for which I got myself a sheet of activated coal that I cut to size and secured into place. And yes, while I think this solution is definitely not perfect, it is well worth it for its low price. And since this gadget does not draw much current, it is pretty well made out of acrylic glass and aluminium, and the utilized boost converter does its job acceptably well, I would kind of recommend it, I think. Okay, moving on to three products at once, who basically all do the same thing. But before I get to that, let me tell you that they were all rather cheap. The most expensive one was 10 euro. And I got them because I was a bit frustrated by my Yokari, whose job it is to remove the outer insulation from my electrical wires. Now don't get me wrong, the Yokari works perfectly fine with standard house cable sizes, but as soon as something gets bigger or smaller, it suddenly becomes pretty useless. And that is why I wanted to try these three out, which according to their product descriptions should be able to do this job as well. I quickly noticed though that the small yellow one was an absolute bad purchase, because it only works with thinner data cables, and its quality is not great. The grey one on the other hand works with thicker wires as well, but here I got the problem that changing between cable sizes takes way too long for me. And that brings me to the red one, which might look a bit cheaply made, but it works wonderfully. Simply select the hole where your wire barely fits through, push down and pull. Super simple, and after doing quite a bit of testing, I can also confirm that the inner insulation of the cable never got damaged, which is really important. So all in all, I initially did not expect that, but after testing, I would actually recommend the red wire stripper tool, while the other ones not so much. Moving on though, next I got myself these two PCBs with integrated battery holder, that you can get for around 4 euro, super cheap. They are in fact a UPS, aka uninterruptible power supply. And at first sight, they seem to do their job perfectly fine, meaning after inserting 18 650 lithium ion cells, we can charge them up with 1 amp of current through the USB-C port, and we can use the 5-volt output of the board to hook up a load like a media player. Now the big selling point of such a UPS is that the load still gets power through the batteries even when the input power disconnects, which, as you can see, works perfectly fine. There is pretty much no downtime when this happens, which was confirmed by my oscilloscope. Other good aspects of the board are that the batteries get charged correctly, the power really comes from the USB port when a charger is connected, the output current maximum seems to be like advertised, and there is an undervoltage protection for the batteries, which is a bit low for my taste though. So at first sight, this product seems useful, right? Well, after having a look at its output with my oscilloscope, I was quite shocked to see how much noise the claimed 5V DC output comes with. I mean, this is so much that it's more like a function generator. And the same problem also applies for the 12V board I got, which, by the way, both have a 5-star rating on AliExpress. So this boost converter design here comes with some serious problems, and I can definitely not recommend it, because a few devices will not be happy with such an output voltage. And with that being said, we come to the last product, which is the small power supply board with display that only cost me around 25 euro. That is super cheap considering it can output 1200 watts, which none of my other lab bench power supplies can do. So as a first test, I hooked up a 24 volt power supply to its inputs and played around with its knob and display bits to not only find out that I can easily set a current and voltage limit, but also that in this case, the max output voltage is only around 23 volts. That is of course because this thing is a buck converter, meaning it can only step down the input voltage. But nevertheless, the voltage outputs and current limit values seem to be accurate. And even after pushing this thing close to its limit with a current flow of 15 amps, it only heated up slightly. Nice. I of course also measured some input and output power values to create this efficiency graph here. That tells us, for example, that with a 12V output voltage, we get an efficiency of above 90%. Not bad. So after playing around with this thing quite a bit more, I was actually pleasantly surprised. And the only complaint so far was that the input fuse is weirdly positioned. But once again, there was a big problem with the output voltage and the occurring noise. As a comparison, here's the noise of a proper lab bench power supply. They are worlds apart. So even though this small power supply does offer a lot for its low price, I cannot fully recommend it after seeing its output voltage. But you do you, and maybe give it a shot anyway. And with that being said, we come to the end of this episode. And this time, there were not too many recommendations from me, but I still hope you enjoyed it. By the way, some of these suggestions come straight from my Discord server, which you can also join by following the link in the video description. And do not worry if one of your submitted hidden gems didn't get featured yet, because there is so much more to cover. Until then, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative! And I will see you next time.